Hey ghouls and gals, welcome back to my channel. My name is Taylor and today's video is going to be my January wrap up. I started the reading year off very strong. I read 11 books, one nonfiction book, and 10 fiction books. So let's just go ahead and get started. I'm going to start off with my nonfiction book because I do go through my fiction books from my least favorite of the month to my most favorite of the month. And nonfiction doesn't really fit within that ranking system because I am reading my nonfiction books for educational purposes and my fiction books for enjoyment. So we'll just go ahead and talk about my nonfiction book that I read this month, and that would be Hood Feminism by Mickey Kendall. So the subtitle to this book is Notes from the Women That a Movement Forgot, and this is talking all about intersectional feminism and going over how different areas of feminism can benefit from looking at different issues through a feminist lens, and also tackling white feminism and different ways that women sometimes are more privileged than other women, and how you have to really include feminism is something that is for everyone, not just white women or not just wealthy women or any sort of privilege like that. So this book goes over a lot of issues that I feel like we don't really consider feminist issues, but that definitely are. So things like food insecurity, access to education, safe neighborhoods, living wages, and medical care are all feminist issues. So going over those issues in a feminist lens, as well as talking about how these issues disproportionately affect women of color, specifically Black women. This book is very educational, made me definitely think a lot about issues that I do care about, but I wouldn't have necessarily framed them as feminist issues, but definitely examining who necessarily is the most impacted by those issues and reframing them to be more feminist and to have a more inclusive definition of feminism. I think this book is very informational and it's also very easily digestible. Mickey Kendall really writes this. I would highly suggest the audiobook, which is how I listened to it. But Mickey Kendall has a very, it's informational, but it also feels like you're sitting almost listening to a TED talk or just listening to someone that you know that is really experienced and knowledgeable talking to you about that information. It feels very informal in that way and very easily accessible. This is definitely a nonfiction book that I think everyone should pick up and check out if you are interested in learning how to kind of combat some privilege that you don't know that you had. This book is really good for beginners in the genre. You don't have to know a lot about these issues before diving in. The information will definitely be given to you in a very easily digestible way. So that was my nonfiction book of the month, and now we're getting into all of the fiction books. So the first fiction book that we're going to talk about this month is Dreamcatcher by Stephen King, and this is a story about four childhood best friends who are really close throughout childhood, kind of drift apart as they become adults, but while they have kind of drifted apart as they've gotten older, they do get together every single winter for a hunting trip together. So this follows the four friends during one of their hunting trips where everything goes very, very wrong. They meet a stranger in the woods and find themselves in the middle of what is potentially an alien invasion and a governmental cover-up of everything going down. I wanted to love this book more than I did. I absolutely love the cover. It's one of my favorite Stephen King covers, and I really love aliens. I think that's just a really fun horror genre. I will say this definitely reads more of like a sci-fi sort of thriller rather than horror, but I feel like they're all sort of genres that play off of each other very well and often play off each other, so I would kind of classify this as a horror sci-fi. I enjoyed it. It's not my favorite Stephen King book. It's not my least favorite Stephen King book. I wouldn't necessarily recommend this to anyone who has never read Stephen King before. I don't think this is a great introduction, but for someone who is newer with Stephen King, I don't think you're going to find a lot to not enjoy in here. Ultimately, I wish this would have been a little bit more on the alien side. Instead, you focus a little bit more on the governmental cover-up side of things. So I kind of wanted a little bit more aliens in this, but the story itself is good. I really don't have any complaints about it. I will say there are several tropes in here that Stephen King does like to use and reuse, and I don't think this is a book where those tropes are done the best. Like, I think you can find tropes in his other books that are done better than in here, but this is still technically like technically in terms of writing and everything, a really good book. I just think if you are a constant reader and you have read pretty much everything Stephen King or like a lot of books by Stephen King, this isn't really going to bring anything new to the table. There are some fun Easter eggs in here. This does take place in and around Derry, Maine, so there are some It Easter eggs, which are really fun. And it is very thick, so if I didn't enjoy it, I wouldn't have like pushed my way through it. But overall, this is a very good, if slightly forgettable, Stephen King book for me. The next book that I'm going to talk about is The Loop by Jeremy Robert Johnson, and this is another kind of blend of horror and sci-fi. Again, I would almost say that it has more of like an action-y sort of sci-fi vibe rather than horror, but this was in the Goodreads Best Horror category. That's why I'm just calling it a horror book. But this is a book about a group of teens who live in a small rural town in Oregon, and one moment these teens are at a party and enjoying, you know, their adolescent selves, and then all of a sudden, something very strange and very paranormal slash otherworldly starts happening. I don't really want to give too much of this one away because I think part of the enjoyment of this book is finding out what exactly is happening, but it's a very like survival horrorist type story about these group of teenagers that have to survive the night in their small town. This was another one that was enjoyable. I liked the first half a lot better than I liked the second half. I think from looking at Goodreads, that's a slightly unpopular opinion. I really liked what was being set up in the first half, and then I felt like the pacing was really good, and then it almost went a little too fast for me. So if you like really fast-paced sort of creature horror, I think you're really going to like this one. For me, I went into this very much blind, so I had no idea whatsoever what I was getting into, and I was really vibing with the story and finding it very interesting when all of a sudden I look down at my audiobook and see that I only have like 30 more minutes left. So it really felt like the whole pacing could be rearranged with this a little bit more. I will say this is being kind of marketed. If you like Stranger Things, you like this. This is set in present day, and it follows teenagers, not a group of kids. And they're not like a group of teenagers, they're a bunch of people who don't really know each other being thrown into a situation. So I don't want anyone going into this thinking Stranger Things, you're gonna get that dynamic and have something else. Again, not giving it away. It does have Stranger Things vibes. Potentially, I'd say a little bit of season three, just in terms of the evil that they're trying to defeat. Again, this is just not the type of horror that I normally am drawn to. I wouldn't have read it had it not been on that Goodreads list. This is very fast and very plot driven, whereas I like more of a slower character driven book. So my enjoyment of this is definitely nothing against this book. It's just, it doesn't have the sort of tropes and sort of style that I enjoy in horror. The next book is, I believe, technically classified as a novella, and that is going to be The Haunting of Tramcar 15 by P. Jelly Clark. This is technically the second installation in a sort of detective mystery creature of the week style of story. You do not need to read the first one to read and enjoy this one. However, I do highly recommend it because the world is built upon a lot more in the first novella, and I enjoyed the first novella a lot more than I enjoyed this one. I still thought it was very solid. I still probably will continue on with the series, but this is about a alternate universe 1920s Cairo, where the fabric between worlds has kind of been ripped open. So creatures from different realms and the afterlife and mythology and things like that are being brought to the streets of Cairo. So you have things like jinn and angels and demons and poltergeists. So in this story, the tram car is being haunted, and two paranormal detectives have to try and figure out how to get this mysterious being out of the tram car. The story is very fun. I thought this is a perfectly paced novella. Both this one and the first one are very, very short, but you do get a cohesive story and feel like you did get a cohesive story within. And I really love the world building. It's so cool. It's a very steampunky sort of 1920s vibe, and you also have Egyptian elements in it in terms of mythology and just world building, which is really, really cool. For me, the reason why this is lower in enjoyment for me in terms of books that I read this month was I really fell in love with the main characters that we get in A Dead Djinn in Cairo, which is the first book in this series. And then this one, we follow two completely different characters, and I didn't like them as much as I did the main characters in the first book. So I'm hoping the characters from the first book return in the third book, because I do really want to continue onwards. But I like the protagonists of the first one way more than the second one, so if it's just the people in the second book, I might not continue. So fingers crossed that we see those characters from the first book return in the third installation of the series. The next book that I read this month was From Blood and Ash by Jennifer L. Armentrout, and this is the first in, I believe it's supposed to be a 6-book series now. You hear slightly different things wherever you look on the internet. I think it was supposed to be a 3-book series, and then a 5-book series, and then a 6-book series. I'm not sure. This book has really been making the rounds on BookTube, let me tell ya. And in the middle of this month, I was looking for a more lighthearted read between some more serious works of fiction and nonfiction, and I just thought I would give this a go. This is a fantasy romance series. It follows a young woman named Poppy, and she is a maiden. And in this society, the maiden is a young woman who has to essentially save herself and her body for an ascension. And she doesn't know what this ascension is. It's some sort of ritual that has been kept secret from her, but she has been saved her whole life for this. She's a very lonely, solitary life, and Poppy has to wear like head to toe veil, which she hates. She can't speak to anyone but her guards and her handmaidens, and that's about it. Poppy really hates her confinement. She hates that this whole destiny has been planned out for her. She doesn't really like the fact that she doesn't even know what the ascension is. She doesn't know what her role as the maiden is and how that will change and what she's really supposed to be doing with that role. She's feeling like she doesn't even want this role that's thrust upon her, and in an act of rebellion against this very strict role, she meets a man who later becomes one of her guards, so one of the only people that she can actually talk to, and his name is Hawk, and they start to have some romantic and very forbidden feelings for each other. Now, this is fantasy romance, so while there are a lot of romantic scenes in this book, and I would say that it does take the forefront of the story, and that tension between Poppy and Hawk is really at the forefront for a lot of this story. There is actually a good deal of world building and other plots that are being introduced, and since this is going to be a larger series, there are some plots that aren't romance based that I am expecting to become more prevalent later on in the series, so I am going to be continuing with this one. It was a whole lot of fun. I will say the beginning of this book was a little bit jarring because this is adult fiction, but it does read a little bit young at times. It does kind of feel like YA in terms of tone and voice, and then you'll get a very steamy scene that it's definitely adult. But I do think that the younger sounding tone was an intentional choice by the author, because Poppy herself is a little bit on the younger side, and she's also very naive about a lot of things happening around her. So you as the reader, it's first person narrative, so you're seeing through Poppy's eyes as she slowly starts to see more of the world and learn more about the world, which is very effective in you feeling like you are getting world building gradually. And it does have like paranormal fantasy elements. The civilization they are in, every single city is surrounded by walls because there are creatures like werewolf and vampire types of creatures that kind of hunt people that are in this world and that are growing to be a more prominent threat to people that live inside these enclosed cities. And there is going to be more of a fantastical element in later books, but it is a spoiler, so I can't really talk about it in terms of the first book, but I thought this was really fun. It starts off very slow. You're not really sure where this plot is going to be going, and the world is very confusing at first, but I will say if you can get past like the first 30% of the book, the pace does start to get better. It starts to pick up, and it was a lot of fun. So I am looking forward to, I probably will continue on with this series because it does have a pretty good blend of fantasy elements, especially I think it'll be more fantasy elements in the later later books and romance, so it was a good blend and just a really fun time. The next story that I read this month was actually a novella, and that would be The Pale Dreamer by Samantha Shannon. This is the prequel novella to the Bone Season series, and I enjoyed this. There's not a lot to say about it. It does set up the world and some relationships and some character building and filling in gaps that you don't necessarily get in the Bone Season. I don't know if I would recommend reading this before the series. I kind of read it in tandem with the Bone Season, and that really helped because it doesn't really build upon the world. I feel like you have to have a knowledge of the world to really understand The Pale Dreamer, but I really enjoyed kind of getting a backstory of what Paige was about before the events that happened in the Bone Season. So not a lot to say about that one, because this definitely, I wouldn't recommend it, you know, as a standalone. It's definitely supposed to be content that helps fill in gaps for a series. So it is like a very smaller plot going on and more of some character development, but I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a fun time and I really enjoyed reading it at the very start of the series when I did. The next book that I read was one that took me a while to read. I think I started this in September or October and then finally got around to finishing it this month, and that would be To Sleep in a Sea of Stars by Christopher Paolini. This book is a sci-fi epic first contact with aliens, so that was a really exciting premise for me. This is the first thing that Christopher Paolini has written since his Aragon series, so it's a very different vibe than a YA fantasy series that is very medieval and very heavily inspired by Tolkien and that sort of fantasy elements, and then this very futuristic sci-fi story. I really enjoyed this. This definitely gives off some Star Trek vibes to me, with the first kind of setup of the story feeling very much like the beginning of the movie Alien, if you've ever seen that. So this is definitely a hard one for me to talk about because there are a lot of things that I really loved about this and a lot of things that I didn't so much care for. I switched to the audiobook and I absolutely started flying through this one. I do have a physical copy, and if I do reread it, I do actually plan on rereading this. It was a fun story, but I think the audiobook is the way to go for this one. And I think this is for a couple of reasons. Number one, the audiobook is absolutely extraordinary. It is a one narrator audiobook, but the narrator herself has done so much for the DC universe in particular, like a lot of the animated cartoons and the video games. She is the voice of a lot of those characters, so she does a great job actually giving a different voice to each character. This felt at times like a full cast narration, which was wonderful. And then secondly, I just feel like this had a lot of pacing issues. This is an almost 900 page book, and I felt like if we wanted to keep it at that page count, definitely should have been at least a duology. There was enough content in here to be a duology, or it could have been trimmed a lot because there is a lot of space travel. And I felt like when the crew was in a conflict, so this follows a space botanist. She's some sort of scientist, and Kira Navarez, who is the main character of this, is a scientist. She's on an exploration on a planet trying to decide whether it's good for human habitation. Humans live on a bunch of other planets, and they believe at this point they are the only other species in the universe. There's a first contact with aliens, and then the conflict really goes from there. I felt like every single time our main characters were on a planet, the pacing was really good. It was enjoyable. I was invested. I wanted to read. I kept thinking about the story and wanting to dive more into it. My nose was glued in the book. And then there would be space travel segments, which were really cool, but they kind of got repetitive because for large portions of the space travel, most of the characters had to be put in cryo because space travel takes a long time. And there were lots of segments like that, which felt repetitive. They weren't as fun as when you got to the next planet. And I felt like other authors maybe would have said they went under cryo and then kind of jumped to a next chapter or something where they were at the next planet. So that didn't happen. So I was either like very, very invested in this book or just kind of was waiting for something else to happen. So I don't know what would change about that for me. And especially there is a turning point in this novel where it really turned around for me. So I think the first, I would say 50% of this took me from September to December with long breaks in between reading this. And then I really committed to switching to the audiobook and not the physical book. And I flew through the last like 400 pages of this book in 2 days. So chalk it up to maybe the audiobook being really, really good or just the pace really, really picking up towards the end. But that was the experience that I had with this book. I do think the characterization was a whole lot better than the actual plot. So that's why I feel like I would probably enjoy this more than some other people because the plot had some issues and I'm not entirely sure I enjoyed what was happening in the story, but I really enjoyed the characters and their dynamic and their problem-solving and just the life that they had on this spaceship. You're really following Kira and this one spaceship, the Wallfish, and all of its crew members. So I really enjoyed those like slice of life parts better than the main plot that was going on, if that makes sense. But at the same time, it was a really interesting story. I really enjoyed it. I also think this is, at least I'm a beginner in sci-fi, so people who read this all the time might not feel the same way for this, but this was also like very science heavy for me. It took Paolini about 9 to 10 years to write this book because a large part he was investigating the science behind different technologies and how these things could actually be like fact instead of fiction. So you could definitely tell everything was very researched and that just lost me at some parts, which the audiobook really helped with because science is not my strong suit. But yeah, overall, I did enjoy this and I would read more. I think it has been hinted that this is the first in the Fractal Verse, so I don't know if it would follow the same characters or not, but I think he's wanting to write more in this sort of timeline. So I'm very interested to see what Christopher Paolini comes out with next. The next book that I read is going to be Monstress Volume 5, War Child, and this is by Marjorie Liu and Sana Takeda. This is the newest installation in my absolute favorite graphic novel series. This is a steampunk horror fantasy about a giant war brewing between monsters and humans and witches and arcanics, these sort of half-human, half-animal beings. Anthropomorphic animals. Just, it's a really cool fantasy world. And it definitely has steampunk vibes and horror vibes. So if you're looking for all of that, I highly recommend this series. Can't say much about it because it is volume 5, but I absolutely loved this one. It gets a whole lot darker from other installations and you see a whole lot more character development in several of the main characters. So I'm really excited. I'm hoping the next volume comes out this year. The artwork is simply stunning. It is a work of art. Every single page is so enjoyable and so gorgeously done, and yeah. I cannot recommend this series enough. I absolutely love it, cannot get enough of it. I probably will do a reread of the first 5 volumes before the 6th volume comes out again, like I said, hopefully later on this year. The next book is a hefty one. That is going to be Kingdom of Ash by Sarah J. Maas, and definitely catching the glare of the ring light, but this is the 7th, I believe, and final book in the Throne of Glass series. So I truly cannot say anything about this book without it being spoilery for the rest of the series. I feel like Throne of Glass is a very popular series on BookTube, so a lot of people should know what it's about. But it is an epic high fantasy story that kind of starts, I would say, as YA and then definitely goes into more of an adult story and storytelling style. And it's following a young assassin named Selena Sardothian, and she has to kind of take on a very corrupt and evil king and then take on some darker powers that emerge that have been giving evil rulers like the king his power. This was just a fun time. I do have some criticism about this series as a whole, but I will say if we want to consider this a purely YA book series, I think if you reread, obviously I wouldn't suggest you doing this on a first read, but if you read Throne of Glass and then you read Kingdom of Ash, the storytelling is vastly different. The themes and the writing style and just the overall tone of the books really go from young adult to more of an adult. I wouldn't say this is like as adult as Crescent City. I mean, that one is definitely an adult title, but this feels weird to me calling it a purely young adult series because it definitely, I feel like there's some growth throughout the series in terms of writing style and also just tone and content. This is like a fantasy romance series. There's a lot of romance in this one. I don't want to say anything is underhyped about this series because it's definitely not. This is one of the most popular series that I see on the BookTurnet in general. And while I did have some problems with this, Sarah J. Maas has a really good world building system. The world in here is so thought out and so thorough, and I also really appreciate an author where book one, there were some things that in hindsight set up this book so perfectly well, and as a reader, that is really gratifying and really exciting, definitely. My biggest complaint for me in this was just how heteronormative this was. And not just that, like the characters are really, I feel like they're all forced into couples. Everyone needed to be coupled up. I felt like once you met a character, you're like, all right, which one of the main characters is this character going to couple up with? Because by the end, slight spoiler, I'm not gonna say names, but pretty much everyone in this book by the end has a romantic match and they're all heteronormative, which it is fantasy romance. So I feel like the romantic pairings are definitely a big draw to this series. But at times it did kind of feel like where Sarah J. Maas was kind of being like, oh, this character doesn't have a love interest. Good thing we have this available character. We'll just smash them together. I felt like definitely some character relationships were a lot more developed and well thought out and just made more sense than others. Also, you know, this book series, very wide, very straight. So those are some genuine complaints of the series as well. But overall, this was just a really good time and I enjoyed it. The world building, the characters were fun. I'm not a big fan of romance, so I know me talking about a lot of fantasy romance is shocking, but I enjoy it every once in a while, I've learned. I feel like especially when you get to series that are 6, 7, 8 books, you definitely need to have a conclusion that is fitting and feels like all the time investment you spent in the previous books was worth it, and I would say this definitely does that. It is a very good conclusion. It's a very positive conclusion. It definitely feels like all the books that you read up prior, you get what Sarah J. Maas has been promising for the last books. So this was just a fun, enjoyable time. And I really enjoyed reading this series for the first time in 2020 and then, you know, bleeding into 2021 because I needed a whole month to read this absolutely massive tome of a book. So the last book that I talked about was very, very much hyped. Doesn't need me hyping it up any more than it already has been. This next book, it needs more hype. Like this book, I have not seen anyone really talking about it and it is so good. I was taken completely by surprise by this one. And that would be These Violent Delights by Micah Neverhammer. This is a very queer, dark academia book set in 1970s Pennsylvania. And it follows two young men as they enter into college. They come from very different backgrounds and they are kindred spirits. They meet each other and they have this spark and they enter into a very intense friendship to relationship, and they have a very unhealthy obsession with each other, and their interests that line up are very dark as well. This is definitely a book where the prologue and the first chapter, you see where the story is going to end up, and then you start from the beginning and see how they got to be in that situation. This book is so good. So if you like morally gray that turns into just definitely bad characters doing bad things in a very, very heavily atmospheric 1970s kind of gothic, very dark academia atmosphere, this book is for you. This book is a debut and it does not read like one. This reads like a modern classic. Now, I haven't actually, this is a call out moment to myself, I haven't finished The Secret History. I've tried to read it a couple of times, had to DNF it, which is crazy, I know, because I absolutely love dark academia. I thought this book was far better than The Secret History, at least from what I've read of The Secret History. So if you like The Secret History, I think you're really going to love this one. I'm so excited to see what this author does in the future. This was just so highly atmospheric, and it is one of those atmospheric books where there is like a plot. I know often on this channel I talk about atmospheric books that tend to not have the most cohesive plots. This one definitely does, and it's just excellently done, and I would love to see this as a film adaptation. I think this would work work so brilliantly well as a film. This one just really, really worked for me, and I had not a fun time reading it because it is very dark. And I will say there are a lot of trigger warnings for this one, including one of our main characters, his father commits suicide, and that is talked about in this book a lot. It doesn't happen in the narrative of the story, but it is something that the character obviously has trauma from and references a lot, and also just depression and anxiety and homophobia because it is the 1970s. I did feel though that it wasn't gratuitous homophobia. So it is the 1970s, so I think it's a pretty realistic depiction of the different shades of homophobia in society. So keep an eye out for that as well. And then just mental health and murder. So if any of that sounds interesting to you, if you think you can deal with it is very bleak. It's beautifully written, wonderfully told, but it is like a darker, bleaker sort of book. But if that is up your alley, this is God's Tear, Dark Academia. And then the final book that I read this month and my favorite book of the month is going to be The Bone Season by Samantha Shannon. So I have read The Priory of the Orange Tree, absolutely loved it. It's one of my favorite books of all time. For The Bone Season, I have not started it. This is my first time reading The Bone Season this year, even though it has actually been on my radar since this book was released, pretty much. And I have no excuse for not picking it up other than the fact that sometimes when I get a hold of something and really think I'm going to enjoy it or think I'm going to love it, it's something I'm working on for myself, but I'll put it off because I don't want it to end. Same with usually last books in the series now, I will put it off because I just don't want the journey to end. Even if I am dying to find out what happens in the rest of the series, I will just space it out. Same thing happened to me for most recently, The Burning God. I could have sat down and read that in a day had I wanted to, and I started on the path of reading it in a day, and I knew it was the last in the series. I wanted it to spread it out as long as possible and for it to never end. So that's kind of what has been happening with the Bone Season series for me. I knew I would like it, and I just have a really bad habit of procrastinating picking up things that I know that I'm going to love, because obviously I'm never going to be able to read this for the first time again. But I'm never going to be able to read the series if I never read this series. So I am working on that this year and not holding things off. And traditionally, I do like picking up series, especially very, very long series, when there is a substantial amount of the series out. So now that the first four books are out and it's a 7-book series, I feel comfortable in picking up this series, and I absolutely loved it. So I don't actually know what this book would be classified as. Science fiction fantasy, maybe urban fantasy with sci-fi elements. It is set in our world in the future, I think in 2059, and it is taking place in an alternate reality of our reality where clairvoyance is a thing and it is illegal to be clairvoyant. Our main character, Paige Mahoney, is one of these clairvoyants, and a very powerful one at that. Clairvoyants are not welcomed in society, and they are eradicated if they are found out. So this starts with Paige being found out as a clairvoyant and being taken into the custody of the government, where she thinks she's going to be put to a speedy traitor's death. However, that is not what happens, and this book really, really goes off in a way that I was not expecting, and it is wondrously fun. I absolutely loved this. This is, again, I feel like a really good mix of an urban fantasy and a sci-fi, with the magic system just being so cool. It's clairvoyancy, but it's different orders of clairvoyance. So some characters have the very traditional, they have tarot cards and can tell the future through there. Some people have a clairvoyance where spirits can come into them and talk through them. Some clairvoyants can enter other people's consciousness. So it's a very intricate, very cool magic system, and it is very well explained. I will say this book can get a little info dumpy, but I think that's because the world, while it is our world in the future, is very different because I'm not the best at British monarchical history, but there is a point where it's supposed that one king opens a gateway and lets clairvoyance in, and that's how some people are born with clairvoyancy in this world. So really, it does kind of feel almost some steampunky vibes and some like older kind of technology vibe, because the states fight against clairvoyance and against people who have this power kind of has influenced the way that society has grown and adapted and changed. So there is a lot of world building, I feel like, especially with these really lengthy fantasy and sci-fi series, and especially ones that have like magics, not only magic systems to build, but worlds to build and history to explain. I personally really don't mind info dumps. I think they're quite helpful. I know a lot of people hate them, but honestly, especially if I'm invested in the world and invested in the story, I love taking little detours to learn info dumps and to really enrich the world. So I thought this was very good. I am very, very excited to continue on with the rest of the series. This really just, once it gets going, once you get past those world building elements, and once you get to the plot twist that happens at the very beginning of this book, it really is a breakneck pace after that, and it's just so fun. And I loved every single minute of it. I love Paige as a main character. I have already started The Mime Order, which is the second book in the series, and I do have books 3 and 4 already, so I have a feeling that the first half of this year is going to be very Bone Season focused, and hopefully I think that Samantha Shannon, this is just me going on a little bit of a tangent, but I think she's announcing her next project at the midpoint of this year, and it's supposed to be Priory related. So this is gonna be the year of Samantha Shannon for me, and I am not mad about it. I had a feeling that I was going to really love this series going into it, and it didn't disappoint. It was definitely not what I was expecting. And I think that is a testament to people who read the series and talk about it online, because this takes you to a place where you do not expect, and I think half of the fun is getting to that point in the book and reading it and being like, okay, I know what this next chapter is gonna be, flipping the page, reading it, and just mind blown at where this book is actually going to go and where the series is gonna go and the conflict that is going to span the 7 books. So kudos to everyone for keeping that a secret, and I wish I could say more about this plot, but that's the fun of finding out. This is definitely not, if you read the dust jacket of this book, it's definitely a lot more intense and a lot more large and sprawling and innovative than the dust jacket gives credit for. So I am absolutely so excited to continue on with the rest of the series. It is a little bit too early to call for me, but I think this has the potential to be one of my new favorite series. And there you have it. Those are all the books that I read in the month of January. If you liked this video, please be sure to give it a thumbs up, leave a comment down below, tell me what your favorite book that you read in the month of January was. And that is going to be it for this video. Go ahead and subscribe to the channel for more content from me. Stay safe, stay spooky, and I'll see y'all on the other side. Bye!